My name is Kenneth Donald Moore. I was born Berkeley, California, December 31st, 1932. I was born with my, in addition to my mother being around, my grandparents, her parents were there. And I don't remember anything before 17 months later when my parents moved to Long Beach, California. And I remember that, being in Long Beach and my grandparents driving down with us. After that, I don't remember.
Can you tell me a much little bit about the home that you were born in?
Yeah, the home that I was born in was my grandparents. My grandfather built in 1904. So it wasn't that old when I was born as it is now. This is 2017 now. So it was a long time ago now. I lived in Long Beach, California, growing up at a very, I remember clearly spending the summers at the beach, and I learned to swim when I was 4 years old. I walked out on a ramp that was built for the 1932 Olympics, and I knew I wasn't supposed to be out there, and the lifeguard said, you know you're not supposed to be here unless you can swim. And I said, I can swim. He picked me up and threw me in the water. I learned to swim very quickly. And I'm sure he would have gone in after me now, but at the time...
You didn't know that.
Yeah, that's right. So then... But most of my summers... I spent back up in Berkeley with my maternal grandparents, and I learned so much from my grandfather. After he built the house in Berkeley, he did it in a time there were no power tools whatsoever. Everything had to be done by hand. And he built a three-car garage behind it. And the reason he built a three-car garage was not because he had a car. He never had a car. But he had the vision that when, in a few years, both he and his two boys would have cars. He didn't have a vision that my mother would have a car. That's interesting. But, yeah. But I mean, then below one of the three garages was a place you could walk under and work underneath the car.
Amazing.
It was amazing.
That anyway, had forethought before.
Yeah, and when he did this, was 100 years before now, they wouldn't even thought about it. I guess the thing I remember mostly now about going to school at elementary school was that I was a so-so student, not particularly good. And then, my parents, my father wanted me to play an accordion. And he made me take an accordion lesson, and it was a big accordion, and I was not a big guy. But I had to carry it around to school and all that stuff. And I hated it. I, believe it or not, I still had the accordion. I haven't played it for 65 years or 70 years, something like that.
You played it at Thanksgiving one year at my house.
I don't remember.
Down at the front house on the farm.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, you brought it out and played it for my kids.
Oh.
Yeah.
I don't remember that. God, I don't. What did I play? I can't even remember what I played anyway. But that was a noose around my neck. That
darn
accordion. Oh yes. And I still have it because everybody says, oh, isn't that neat? I said, you want it, you can have it. But nobody's got it, picks it up for free even so. Then that was about when I got to high school. I went to the first half of the 10th grade into a private Seventh-day Adventist school in Newbury Park, which is near Los Angeles to the northwest. And I was there for one semester. I was given the job of running the laundry. And unfortunately, a girlfriend of mine came down and joined me at about 4 o'clock in the morning. And her, a girl that didn't like her, told people that were running the place that they were there. And they jumped all over me and said I was doing the wrong thing. And I said, well, she didn't think it was the wrong thing, but that's the way it went. And then from that point on, they had me shoveling chicken manure for half the value per hour that I was getting before. So at the end of that semester, it was considered best by the school and my parents that I get out of there. And then I went to stay with my great aunt, Julia. That's my father's mother's aunt in Berkeley, in Long Beach, I'm sorry, near Signal Hill. And went to Wilson High School in Long Beach, which was an academic school, until I graduated. But before I graduated, I had been in the Sea Scouts. And then as soon as I, from age 14 and a half, and then when I was, the day I turned 17, I joined the Navy, Naval Reserve. And you had to have your parents' permission, so they raced me down to sign me up to get rid of me. But when I was 3 years old, 1936, a very interesting occurrence I was party to. It was the wedding of my father's younger brother, Bruce, to a Simpson lady of known family in England, but not here. And I was the ring bearer, and I dutifully dropped the ring. And I was waiting outside before I went in for that, and there was this enormous noise overhead. I had no idea what it was. And I had a great aunt of mine, Aunt Beatrice. I said, what is that? She said, that is a Zeppelin, a flying, and it was a huge one, just enormous, and it was flying very low. I don't know the name of it or anything like that, but it was 36. Now, the same thing that happened at the same time, in England, the Queen Mary was going into service at the huge passenger ship in England, in Southampton. Exactly 50 years later, I went to a golden wedding anniversary of the same couple that just got married. And it turned out it was held on the Queen Mary in Long Beach. And was exactly the same age as their years of marriage was exactly the same as the service of the Queen Mary. And miraculously, I don't know how that happened, all of the wedding party, including myself and the flower girl, were in attendance at this golden wedding anniversary. Well, we were only in our 50s, so that was not unusual. But the fact that the bridesmaids and the ushers and that sort of thing were there was kind of remarkable, because they would be, you know, between 70 and 80.
They all survived.
That long, yes. Now, all of those people have long passed now, because... When I was growing up in Long Beach, I would leave the house, like say I was 10 years old, I would leave the house in the morning and maybe not come back at lunch, come back by dinner, and there was no thought at all about that being a problem. Now, what I was doing was, some things were, you know, jumping on the back of a railroad trains and things like that, that I probably shouldn't have been doing, but nevertheless, I got to learn to do a lot of things, because that combined with my grandfather taught me, my gosh, I was so lucky to have that. I'm hoping that Oliver will feel that way about me.
Of when your father yanked the cord out of the when you were 8 years old?
Yeah, when I was 8 years old, we were living in Long Beach, and I was sitting down in a booth in the kitchen, a small house, and something was plugged into the wall, and I can't remember exactly what it was, into a 110 volt AC. Now, I didn't know that at the time, but I mean, I couldn't explain what it was at the time, but I knew what it was. And all of a sudden, it sparked and stopped. And my father reached over and grabbed the wire, not the plug, the wire, and yanked it out. Of course, it didn't come out. The wire came out separately. And he turned to me and said, "Now you fix this." Because he didn't know how to do it at 8 years old. And I did. I didn't think there was anything odd about that. Yeah, my grandfather would be disappointed if I didn't know how. Yeah. Yeah, actually, my mom was pretty good about things. She could do a lot, really.
Because she had also grown up with Gramps.
That's right. Yeah. That's it, yeah. My father and I were not at all close. That's a gross understatement. He was not nice to my mother, and I'll just leave it at that. But I spent all the time I could with my grandfather, you know. And then when I was going to the academy and I had weekends off, I would spend with them in Berkeley. I was just so happy, and we'd be working in the shop together, or he would be teaching me, what was it, card game? I can't remember it making a difference. Just,
Whist?
What?
Was it Whist?
No.
Bridge?
No, it's another one. He did play bridge, and I played with him. But I was trying to think of another one. It doesn't make any difference. But it was, we spent so much time together, and it was such a blessing. He taught me how this house was built on a hill, and it would slide a bit.
It's Craigmont Hill, right?
Yeah, right. And so he could, the house didn't have a proper foundation. because it was would move. So he built it on these 20-some foot long 12x12s.
Wow.
And he would adjust them each year. And I said, well, how'd you do that? Oh, it's really easy. You know, you just put a jack under one of them at a time, and then you block that up and go the other end, do the same thing. It takes a while, but, you know. So I passed this on to the current owner. I said, that's why you're having trouble. You didn't know this. And if you listen to me, how what to do, but I don't know if they could. They would know how to do what I told them to do it, you know, how to do it. But, yeah, and they didn't. The garage is not in good shape. That's, they haven't taken care of that very well. But my grandfather, my great grandfather, that's Nana's father, said that they could build a house there, that they did, and my grandfather built it there. Then my great-grandfather changed his mind after it was built and said, no, you're going to have to move out. I want to rent that to somebody else. And this is when you have a wonderful experience there. It wouldn't happen today, but the court system then was different. It was the only time my grandfather ever went to court. He took that to court, and the judge brought in this guy, and he said, you're doing this to your daughter? And he said, not only am I saying against you, I want to see you come in next week with a quit claim deed on that property to them. Now, you couldn't get by with that today, but it's a fair thing.
Yes.
It's the way it should be.
It's justice.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. Things are a lot different now. You have somebody that could just do it, you know, and then it would take something awfully big, you know, probably the state legislature to overrule it. But, you know, they don't even want to do that, get involved with something like that. Mm-hmm. That's why he's there, to make those decisions. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember in fact, I know who it was. I'm trying to think of his name. But he was a, he had been, before he was a judge, he was a preacher.
Oh.
And you didn't have to necessarily be an attorney to be a judge. In fact, you still don't even have to be. It mostly are, but this guy, I'm trying to remember his name now. I can't right now. But he was very close to the family, and it was really something. He's also the guy that while he was a preacher, he was did the baptism for my mother, you know, and that sort of thing. You know, boy, so what he must have thought of this, you know, he probably would have, if he could have gotten wild, he probably would have had the guy whipped. I mean, that's just so crazy, you know.
Absolutely.
And you know what happened a short time later? The house that he lived in, my great-grandfather lived in, right in back, burned down. There was a big fire that burned it down, and he didn't even have it insured. But that was not anything with my grandfather, and fortunately, nothing. And I don't know where they went after that, and I didn't care. I mean, I that was before I was born, so I didn't really know anything about what they were doing. In 1947, I would have been 15 years old, and I was in the Sea Scouts in Long Beach. And we would go out every weekend on either that or work on the boat. It was a 28-foot, two-masted dipping lug, a rig. And we would go out on San Francisco Bay. Well, during this time frame, Howard Hughes and the government had a deal. The government and Howard Hughes together at the time wanted to build a vessel that could hold a battalion of troops, a seaplane. He was convinced, Howard Hughes convinced, that he could build one and it would work. Well, the trouble is, things changed in the way of technology while it was being built. It was to be an 8-engine seaplane, monohull, made out of plywood. And for some reason, I guess it was the media, somebody in the media nicknamed it Spruce Goose. Well, there's no spruce in it, but in the media, if they don't know something, they'll make up a name to put in there, right?
Yeah.
That's part of what's happening today in the media and why our current president's all pissed off at the media. If they don't have an answer, they'll make it and put it in there. And this particular summer of 47, no, we knew that there was something, we knew what was being built, where it was being built, but it had been for so many years in this building status and covered by, they covered it up because we didn't even know anything was going on in there. It was not very far away from our Sea Scout ship, maybe a mile or so, two. And you just saw it sitting there and everybody just forgot about it because it didn't mean anything. The war was over and that sort of thing. Well, the government wanted to forget that they'd made this deal with him, and he had actually put in a whole lot more of his own money into it. So the media said that he was trying to rip off the government. Well, the fact is the government was the one that wanted it to begin with, and he said he could do it. So they went, this one day, we didn't know it at all, what was going on. So all of a sudden, we saw this thing sitting out in the middle of the bay, this giant, really giant plane. And we couldn't understand what it was doing there. And then pretty soon, we were about 3 or 4 miles away from it, but the engines started, all 8 of them. Not at the same time, one after the other got started. And it taxied down to one end of the east end of the bay. The bay face at that point doesn't face to the west, it faces to the south. Mm-hmm. And So when you got to the far eastern end, they taxied around and gunned the engines full power. And actually, it wasn't even going to test. They weren't going to take off. It was just a test to see if things would work up to that point. And he figured, well, we're going to go this far, I'm going to take off. So he actually took off. And it was only about 60, 70 feet out. But it was quite a ways, distance ways. But it went fine. And then he cut the power down, went back in again. Everything went absolutely smoothly. The problem was, they really didn't need it.
Yeah.
Because prior to World War II, all of the transoceanic planes were seaplanes.
I did not know that.
Because they wanted to be able to land if they had troubles. Okay. All of them were that way. And so the first ones on a regular basis was in 35 when the seaplanes left from San Francisco Bay to Hawaii, to Wake, to Midway, and over to Japan and that sort of thing. And it was a regular, a Pan American.
Yes.
Pan American Airlines had it. It was a very good operation, except it was extremely expensive. And it wasn't they're trying to make a lot of money, it was just the number of passengers you could have in there for the cost it took to get it up and all. The most difficult person to get was the stewardess. She had to speak two foreign languages, she had to be a nurse, qualified nurse, and they'd be a cook.
Oh my God.
Because they made everything. They had no way of keeping things then. So all these things had to be done from scratch. And she had to make the beds too, and people slept in there. I mean, this is the way it was at the time. And of course, when the war came along to us, that stopped. There were no civilian planes going across the Pacific. Mm-hmm. Or they get shot down, you know. Mm-hmm. So, because the stops they made before were at Hawaii, mm-hmm. Midway, Wake, and then to either the Philippines or, you know, Hong Kong or back up to Japan, but not much there. But so that's how they worked. Well, by building a large seaplane, you could fly a full battalion. But the cost for that plane and to fly it was horrendous. And so then the magic was that during World War II, we flew something like 12,000 B-17s from the Atlantic coast to England without a single one falling in the water.
Mm.
Well, why are we? It costs three times as much to build the seaplane as you are doing for that. So it didn't make sense. So the government wanted to back out of the deal, and they're blaming. You know, he's just trying to rip money off. I just think it's, you know. Now, of course, he wanted to see it get done because it was, wanted to prove that it could be done. But the government just wanted to get out of the deal. So from that point on, they were still sending troops by sea. Because at the time that Annie was born, I was mate on a large combination passenger troop ship. But now it's come around to the cost of flying. You can get almost a battalion on one plane, like a C-47, mm-hmm. 747, for far less money than it would have been for the seaplane. So the quote spruce groups never again flew, not once ever, and it was sit right alongside in Long Beach, right alongside the Queen Mary for a long time, and then some other, but it didn't really have much interest. And some outfit up in Oregon bought it. And that's where it is now, and I don't even know the town it's in or what, or why they would even want it. What would you do with it? You know, I mean, it's nothing, you know, I mean.
But you witnessed the only flight.
I witnessed the only flight that it ever made, yes. So, and right next to it was is the Queen Mary, and I had a marriage, a wedding on the Queen Mary also in my third wife. And this was on, I'm trying to remember the exact year. I think it was 78 maybe. I'm trying to remember. Well, okay. How old was Forrest when he was 12? Okay, then we can do it for then. He's now 39, right?
No, he's 40.
He's 40 now. Okay, well, pretty close.
Yeah.
Oh, he just turned 40. That's right. Yeah. Okay. Well, so let's just call it 40 then. That means that it would have been, huh?
It would have been 38 years ago. No, I mean, not 38, 28 years ago.
Yes, 28 years ago is when I got married on the Queen Mary. And present then was you, mm-hmm. Andrea, and two bridesmaids with Serena and Heather, and the usher was Forrest, and the maid of honor was a lady from
Sri Lanka,
right? And she came over from England. She was living in England at the time. She came to London. She came over, and the guy that gave the bride away was, what's his name now? Alex. Can't remember his last name. But he was from London also. Anyway, that was, and then the really a bit more, it was really something that it would happen to be all in Queen Mary, but also we're going to have the reception on the Queen Mary, but the bride said what she wanted to have in the reception. And it was an English thing. And I said, you can't have that on the ship. She walked off. I mean, she was not going to tolerate that. When I graduated from high school in Long Beach, and I was in the Naval Reserve still, and then I had been accepted to the Maritime Academy in Vallejo. And I need to get some money together badly, because nobody's going to pay for my my tuition, my parents weren't, and the government wasn't. So what happened was that I applied for and granted, I was accepted as a lifeguard in Long Beach, which was kind of something else. It's very surprising that I was, because I think there was only one other person that was a high school graduate that was applying. The others were, junior and senior college swimmers and things like that that had more experience than I did. Don't know that they were better, but I couldn't tell. I didn't know. The only other person that knew about my age was a guy in my class. And he had already made it the year before because his father was the head of the lifeguards.
Oh.
Not, it wasn't given to him. I mean, he had to earn it, but he had the chance to. Mm-hmm. Well, you had to do two things. You had to go out and surf 200 yards, down 1,000 yards, and back another 200 yards to the beach. And you had to be within the top 10 people to doing it. And there was 150 guys out there doing, This is not on the beach in Long Beach, the ocean beach. Anyway, so then the other thing you had to do is, run down the beach 200 yards, swim out, 200, back again, and then get that, and then run back again. Now that didn't sound like much, but it changes your muscles a lot, what you have to do. And I did that. And at the time, I went out in the first long leg. There was a boat at the turning point. And in the boat was my classmate that was already in it. I said, how far behind that? He says, there's nobody ahead of you. But you couldn't see because of the way. I mean, it wasn't like a swimming pool where you could tell. And I got down there. And then I went in, and I started to go in, and I thought, I'll just catch a wave, but that might be illegal. I don't want to get disqualified. So I swam in, and so I wasn't the top, but pretty well up there. And by the time this thing was over, I was tired. I fell asleep. And I got more sunburned than any other. Only once ever I got a sunburn. It was that. That was in, what was
it? In New Zealand,
yeah.
For the America's Cup?
Yeah, I got burned for that. Same thing. But that's because the atmosphere is different there, and I can't tell what it was, but anyway. So that was, yeah. So then I had enough money, but I didn't spend any money at all that year, that summer, 3 months. I didn't spend a penny on it because I was living at home and it's only two blocks away from where I was.
Did you just walk there?
Yeah.
And wasn't there also a weight requirement?
Oh yeah, I had to weigh 150 pounds. Mm. That was the minimum weight, and I weighed 138.
Oh no.
And so I had to gain that much in a certain period of time. I can't remember what it was, about 2 weeks, I think it was, something like that. And I crammed down bananas and milk. And I made it by a couple pounds, I don't know. I went to the bathroom very quickly after that. Both ends, barf, whatever. Well, what the heck, you know? You do what you have to do.
Yeah.
That thing's still on?
It's still on.
Oh, yeah. They were listening to all this wonderful thing about me.
I love it.
Yeah, that was... And my mother found me on the beach.
Did she?
Yeah, thank goodness. Because I was asleep.
Yeah.
And I was getting burned.
Yeah.
And I didn't know until she got there and I started to get up. And oh, gosh, it was bad. And so I went, yeah. I was peeled a lot, you know. It was really badly burned. But, I mean, not life-threatening, but it was uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. But, that was it. But and I had the... Had enough time, you know. And I guess I'm just wondering why they gave me the job I got. I was the only one that they gave that job to. Was at the Colorado Lagoon.
Oh, I've been there.
I know, but I'm saying I was the only new lifeguard that was assigned there, and I was assigned at night. And I guess I found out why when I got there.
Why?
There was a guy by the name of, by the official name of Bob Gravage.
Oh.
Whose nickname was Hammerhead. And who had brought, he and Uncle Al and Burrhead and one other brought the board surfing from Hawaii over to there in the 30s.
Yeah.
And I didn't know that. I didn't know anything about it. What?
You didn't know Uncle Al at that time.
No, I didn't. And I didn't know, well, right when I met him, I didn't know Hammerhead at all. And he never even wore a formal bathing suit. He was, you know, kind of God, you know, and around there. And so when I was there, I ended up with more rescues than anybody in the whole lifeguards because it was a small area and a lot of people would get in trouble in that area. And I think there was only two times that Hammerhead ever got wet. He had this dory. Move around it, and he saw somebody in trouble. He would call me, and he pointed to them. It's up to me to, you know. Well, hey, look, you know, what am I going to say? Yeah, he taught skiing in the winter and did lifeguarding in the winter and the summer, and he was working on his master's degree in instruction, and he wrote on how to build, teaching somebody how to build a surfboard. Well, nobody knew as much in the world as he did about it. So the only thing for him is how to put it in a way to explain it to people to do it, not how to do it, really. So he was going to school in the daytime at USC, University of California. That's a Catholic school. He had a dog named Corky, and he had a 1938 Woody that he lived in, and had this little stack that we, you know, you call a, what do you call it, when short stack for, it'll come out of my head anyway. Anyway, so he would live in that, and so one day they had a lifeguard meeting down at the headquarters. And I think they only do about once a year or something like that. Well, they had all the lifeguards had to sit on the deck except for the captain. Captain Taylor, the lifeguard, was Miller. Dutch Miller, he was it. And if you'll recall, down there at the time, maybe you can't, I don't know, there was this big towering building for diving.
Yes.
You remember it? Okay. Well, that was part of the 1932 Olympics. Mm-hmm. For 5, 7, and 10 meter diving. Well, we had the Corky, his dog would run up and down, up in the rafters of that place. Nobody used it anymore. And chase the pigeons that were up there and that sort of thing. And so who cared? I mean, what? So this one day we had this lifeguard meeting. And everybody had arrived except for Hammerhead. And the chief said, "Where's Gravage?" And so I was the one to have to speak up because I would work with him, you know. And I said, "Well, I just passed it. He's here, and the smoke coming out of his, I'm trying to think of what you call it, coming out of, and he was cooking something in his woody. Well, tell him to get in here." Well, a very short time after that, I didn't even get up and get out, when the door knocked, and in comes Gravage, carrying this great big silver tray with this bird that he'd cooked. So he put it on the deck. So this is for the night owl shift for you, Captain. He said, "Gravage, that's not an owl. It's one of those pigeons your dog chased down, and all the ladies in town are calling me about, complaining your dog is chasing the bird." And he was right, dead right. Yeah, it was funny. It was funny. But yeah, he was. Yeah, he and Uncle Alan, Burrhead and one other, I don't remember his name, brought the board surfing from Hawaii to Southern California, and they did a lot of it down at. A lot of the surfing was down in. It's on the grounds of Camp Pendleton, the Marine Corps base. Starts with an O. San Onofre. That's it. And I went there one time with a 17-foot plywood paddleboard, and it took two people to carry it, to try to surf with that, you know. Well, obviously, I'm lucky I didn't kill myself, you know. I failed utterly.
Did it have any fins on it?
No. It didn't have anything. Only an idiot standing on it. Gosh, yes. But Heather went there a lot, you know. She knows about it a lot, and when I mentioned Hammerhead, she was astounded that I would even know him. And so I said, "Well, have you talked to Uncle Al?" He said, "No." I said, "You talked to Uncle Al. He knows all about him." He says, "Gee, I know he's." She says she knew he was a big hero, you know, in the surfing business. But I didn't know. I mean, I knew that he had brought it over, but I didn't know anything more than that. Mm-hmm. It didn't seem to mean that much as it does to her. 6 months after I joined the Naval Reserve, I was on 2 weeks active duty at submarine school at Hunters Point in San Francisco. And the day, I'm trying to remember the exact day, I think it was the 25th of July, or either June or July, It was the day that the North Koreans walked over the 38th parallel and started the Korean War. And of course, we didn't know what that was going to mean to us. But in fact, it didn't mean anything because the submarines had very little effect on an operation in the Korean War, except they did have some of them that were modified to take the torpedoes out and put Marines in there. They didn't fire the Marines out, but they just stayed there. And then they would take the Marines ashore in certain places on the Korean Peninsula. After graduation in 1951, I had applied for and was accepted to the California Maritime Academy. However, since I had already signed with the Navy, I had to get the Navy's permission to do that. They were very happy to let me go there. They didn't pay for it. I paid for it. It's not a military school. I mean, a governmental school. And I had to pay my own tuition there. And the condition was that after I graduated with my license, and I had to accept a commission in the Navy, and I'd go on active duty. That's what happened. And I went on active duty and was sent to Long Beach, California, to a vessel called the Caliente, which is a fleet oiler. And I was sent there as the navigator. Which was a little unusual for the Navy because they usually sent people, junior officers, to the captain to put on duty however he saw fit. But since this was not a standard Navy ship, it was a converted merchant ship tanker, they assigned me and the chief engineer specifically for those jobs because we had licenses. Mm-hmm. And that meant a whole lot more than just being an ensign. And so I had the best, most interesting year, 2 years of my life as far as the job is concerned on the Caliente, making trips to the Far East. And in 1956, I was at the bikini tests. And while there on the ship, I bought an 8mm camera. And I didn't take any pictures of the test, but I took pictures of where I was in the Far East, the balance of that trip before we got back to the United States, and it was in Taiwan, Japan, Hong Kong, and
when they did those bikini tests, did you have any protective gear?
No, I didn't. Well, I corrected. Everybody on the ship was called on deck, and all the enlisted people were sat down on the deck, facing the opposite direction of where the flash was going to come. We were 30 miles away, because I put the ship where we were supposed to be because I was a navigator.
I think some of your grandchildren might not know what the bikini tests were about.
Oh, these were the tests for the atomic bomb. It was after... shortly after World War II, but it was as in 56, so it was just 10 years afterwards. And I felt uncomfortable about the thing, I'll tell you the truth. I didn't know what was going to happen. Of course, they didn't either. And that's the thing, you know. It wasn't they were trusting us for... a friend of mine that I met later by the name of Bill Borns at the same time was in tests. He was in the Marine Corps, and he was on ground tests in, I guess it was either New Mexico or Nevada, someplace like that. And he was in an assignment, it was called, they named the group he was with the Special Test Unit. Yeah.
You didn't want that moniker after you.
Yeah, you know, and so I was there for two different tests that time. First test, I went into the, we didn't have a real CIC at the time. We had a radar room, and I wanted to see what it looked like on the radar. That was interesting to me, and I didn't have any reason. And this was before, long before, it was about 4 o'clock in the morning, so there was no, it was dark as could be at the time. Well, the next time that we did went out there, the captain told me I had to get out there and on the bridge wing. And then he said, we have special glasses for you. I didn't like it at all. And, you know, he said, you're supposed to be an officer. You're not supposed to be a coward. You know, if I knew what was going to happen and was afraid of it, you could call me a coward, maybe, but nobody up there knew had any idea what the hell was going to happen. So it's not cowardice. It's just what the hell's going to happen next.
Yes.
And the enlisted people that were everybody from down below was sitting on deck, and they were facing away, and they had their head in the crook of their arm, just like that. And it was 4 o'clock in the morning.
And they're facing away from.
And they were facing away from the flash. When it went off, everyone saw their bones.
Unbelievable.
Every single one saw their bones right through the sleeves and all. Oh, so, you know, we didn't know what the hell was going to happen. You know. Each of these bombs were different and larger than the ones dropped in Japan. A different type entirely. They were called thermonuclear bombs instead of atom bombs. I don't know the difference. I realize there's a chemical difference, but I didn't know what it was. And so right after it went off, we were told to steam around. It was in a Bikini Atoll. Mm-hmm. If you know what an atoll is, it's coral from the bottom of the ocean, flattens out and comes up like a mushroom. And there are little islands around the edge of it. And we went, after the bomb went off, in 4 hours we steamed in right inside. I have made a point not to ever try to find out what happened to any of the people I was with. It would only be negative.
Yeah.
And Bill Borns had done the same thing with the Marines that he was with. He didn't want to know.
Yeah.
And I just feel lucky. And this idea of cowardice is absurd. Because you can't say it, you're a coward if you don't know what it is.
Yes.
But anyway, I went up on the flying bridge that afternoon and to sun myself, and I was in there was this little sort of a gun tub open thing that had originally had 20 millimeters in it that was just empty. We didn't use them anymore. And at towel down. I was laying down, sunning myself. And all of a sudden, I heard these people clunk, clunk, come up. And they were guys all dressed in special white suits with Geiger counters, and it was going off.
Oh my God.
Well, it turned out that what it was, when it got close enough to me, it was on the radium on my watch was what set that off.
Oh, thank you.
But you know, this isn't fun. You know, I don't want to come here again. So after the second one, our ship was sent, not because I cared, but we were sent to Guam was the next stop on that particular trip, and it was nothing to be remarkable about Guam. I think I went to Manila right after that and then went back up to Japan. Japan and Kyushu, the southern island, is a place called Sasebo, which was a major port of storage for fuel in the mountains. And that was the reason the ship's tanker was there. I really very much enjoyed the 2 years I spent on the ship, except for the little bikini venture, because I had no boss, really. The ship would get orders, the captain would see them and hand them to me and says where to go, what to do, and that was my job. Mm. And he knew it. The first captain I had was a guy named Richard Copeland, who, strangely enough, had graduated from the Massachusetts Maritime Academy and then went to Annapolis. And I could never figure that out. I never got an answer from him why. His father had been the superintendent at Massachusetts Maritime Academy, which is the same level as the school I went to. Mm-hmm. Why he wanted to do this, God knows, I really liked him a lot, very competent officer, obviously. And it took me 4 hours to relieve the guy whose place I was taken, that's all. Because he had graduated 2 years before me at the same school I went to, same teacher, everything. He knew what I knew about navigation and how much time we spent doing it. It was every semester and every trip at sea.
Every semester you'd go out on the Golden Bear, wouldn't you?
Yes, we would go for a full, 4 months on that, three times. We did that 3 years in a row, and we did everything there was to know about navigation, upside down, stars, everything. Well, 2 years after I relieved, I got relieved by an Annapolis graduate who did not have the same designator that I did. They did away with that because they really had the special designator because the Navy had never up till that time built auxiliary ships. They'd only built combatant ships. And the structure, everything about it was entirely different. But we were trained to operate on maritime ships, so it made sense until this guy came aboard. And his name was Dick Blaze, a very bright officer. He had gone to Annapolis, and when he graduated from Annapolis, he was sent on to a destroyer in the engineering department. And from that, his 2 years there, they sent him to relieve me. Well, it didn't mean anything to me. I knew nothing about his background or anything. So he came aboard in Sasebo, Japan. And I was going to catch a plane home the next day. Why not, you know? Mm-hmm. Didn't take me long. So I welcomed him aboard, and I said, come on up to the chart house. And I'll show you where we are and all. And I said, well, right now, we're here in Sasebo, and our next orders are to make a show the flag trip down in Sydney, Australia. And from there, and so it's just directly south, so you can just do a rum line, and there's no comp, not much navigation involved. We just don't run into islands, you know. But then from that point, you got to go to San Francisco, so you have to calculate a great circle route. And he looked at me, he had no idea what I was talking about.
Oh my goodness.
And so I said, let's stop right here. I want you to tell me from the time you went to Annapolis about your navigation. He said, in the whole 4 years I was there, I had one semester of navigation. Very basic stuff. And the last year I was on the summer I was on the battleship Wisconsin, and I was assigned to do a navigator's day's work, which is a lot of things. All 3 days that I was assigned to do that, it was foggy. I have never shot a sunline in my life.
Oh my God.
And he was going to relieve me to safely take this ship. And we were alone most of the time. We had a different captain then. And that captain had been to Annapolis, but he'd never navigated either. He was on a submarine. And I won't go into that, but.
Did you cancel your flight home?
Well, of course, yes. 4 months later, I got home. Because,
yeah.
Well, the CD had no idea, you know. He learned very quickly from knowing nothing at all. I had no problem with that, but there were so many things to learn, and especially celestial navigation. We didn't have any things like they have today. The only addition, we of course had radar if you're close to land, but we had Loran, which was not very good at the time. Loran A, it was the most basic thing, and it was not a very good assist. And I used it from time to time, but I'd rather see the stars than see that, because I knew what to do with them. And but then after that I went ashore. I finished that 2 year tour of duty, but I stayed from that point through. I can't remember now, until I think 1985, I stayed in the reserve. And so when the whistle blew, I'd do, you know, that sort of thing. After I got that tour, I immediately went to a school called the American Institute for Foreign Trade, which was in Glendale, Arizona. And halfway through that, well, I guess I should have said that as soon as I got off of active duty on the Caliente, I met and married my first wife, Wilma. It took us, I met her on Thanksgiving. We got married the 26th of January. I won't try to say that was smart at all. I was way too young.
But you got six kids.
I got six kids. But she was 4 years younger than me and at the same grade level. And that wasn't because I failed. She graduated as a valedictorian of her high school class at age 14 and matriculated directly to UC Berkeley. Now, she had academically great things. The problem with that is that she, unfortunately for her, she had no social graces whatsoever. For example, the daughter I'm talking to right now wanted to learn to ice skate. And she said, all right, I'll give you ice skating lessons, but in 2 years you have to be in the Olympics. She actually said that to her. I mean, this is, you know, there's just, everything had to be A plus or you weren't worth anything.
Yeah.
So anyway, then after halfway through the school, going back to the American Institute for Foreign Trade, I got a summer off because I went to the backwards the spring semester first, then off in the summer, and back again in the fall. So I had the two semesters of there backwards. But that was because, to be honest with you, because white people did not live in that part of Arizona in the summertime. The Indians did live there, but they didn't work. Nobody could work. It was just too damn hot. They didn't have mechanical refrigeration then. They only had swamp coolers, which doesn't do a lot of good. So, but during that summer, I went back to sea on a large passenger ship as a mate, combination troop ship and passenger ship owned by the Military Seal Command, called MSTS at the time. And while I was on the trip, the daughter I'm talking to right now was born. I was in Guam at the time. And fortunately, a classmate of mine from the academy sent a message. The only reason I knew that she was even born was he sent a message illegally to the ship telling me that that she'd been born and everybody was okay. And I remember when I came back, before I left on that trip, I was really concerned, although I knew that I knew my job well, technically. The most senior captain with MSCS was the captain of that ship. The name of the ship was the Gaffey. And first day we were going out, from San Francisco. It was very foggy, and I had the watch, and up comes the captain. He was a Norwegian with really heavy accent. Anderson was his name. And I felt I had to say something because the captain came up and I said, it's burning off up there, Captain. Yeah, but we're not going that way. I didn't say a word to him all the way to Yokohama. I was so embarrassed. But what do you say, you know? But now, let me tell you, the bottom line of that story was when we came into, at the end of the trip, we came into Long Beach. No, to San Francisco. To Fort Mason, to dock. I had the watch then, and the but not doing anything because the pilot was running the ship at the time, and the captain was standing next to me, and I saw my wife and first daughter, Ondine, and this baby that turned out to be Andrea here, in her arms, standing on the dock. And he said, is that your wife? I said, yes, sir, it is. He reached in his pocket and he pulled out his keys and he says, you see that car over there? That's mine. I will need it at 6 o'clock tonight over in Oakland. Here's your keys.
Oh.
And that's some same guy. So it's.
So you proved yourself after all.
Well, apparently, yes. It's part of my experiences, you know, that made me whatever good or bad I am now that came to be. And then after graduating from that school, the grad school, I went to I joined a steamship company called Likes Lines, L-Y-K-E-S. It's not known today, but at the time it was the much largest American flag steamship line. And they had seven lines around the world. And the headquarters was in New Orleans. And so I went, they took me for, they would take somebody each year into a management training program. And they were anxious to have somebody with my background to start with. So between the three things, my academy graduation, my post-grad, and plus the time I was at sea and all, was good for them, and they felt was, and because I was still quite young. 1957, I think it was. I'm pretty sure it was 57, that way one year or not, that I went to work with, I went to work with Likes. And I lived in New Orleans, and that was a wonderful time to live in New Orleans. It was just a whole lot of fun. I really loved it a lot. We had a little slave quarter apartment in right in the French Quarter. And I remember lots of fun stories, but one of the stories we had in this, we had a little plastic swimming pond, and one day I walked out, and then Ondine was upset. Ondine was, my eldest daughter at the time was 3, I'm guessing. Mm-hmm. And Andy was a year and a half old, I think it was. Yeah, she's nodding yes. And Ondine came up to me, and she said, Look at what she did. She launched a torpedo right in the swimming pool. She was so upset about that. You know, and it's, yeah, what do you do except laugh? I mean, what? But about a month or so after that little incident, I remember the third daughter was born. Her name was Sabrina, and she was born in a hospital in New Orleans. Trying to remember the name of it now, I'd have to think hard, but it doesn't make any difference. But it was, I was at sea again, believe it or not. I was on the, attached to a destroyer, still involved with the reserve. I was a navigator on a destroyer that was off that weekend. So two of the officers on the ship, wives came and stayed with my two older daughters. Well, the wife went to the hospital to give birth to Sabrina. I remember that. Kind of interesting, isn't it? And they came back, and everybody was happy. Nobody. And she was happy because, the mother was happy because for this birth, particularly because there was no antibiotic of any kind in any part of it, just nothing at all. Whereas the first time she was very proud to have a child, having gained no weight at all. She, at the time she went in to give birth, she weighed the same thing she did when she got pregnant. And so you can imagine what she looked like.
And she wasn't heavy to begin with.
No. And she looked like a skeleton.
Yeah.
Not healthy at all. But she was proud to be able to do that. But I, you know.
Because all the nurses encouraged them not to gain a lot of weight at the Naval Hospital.
Well, I don't know, maybe. Whatever it is, it doesn't make sense. But after going back to being in New Orleans, I was sent to, I wanted to be get my first real job after the training program. And I wanted to go either to Manila or to Barcelona, Spain. The company had offices in both those locations, and they had an operations boss in each of those locations, and I was qualified for that part.
And we're talking about likes lines, right?
That's right. And so they didn't send me there. They sent me to a job that was a notch higher than that, but in Galveston, Texas. So my family and I moved to Galveston, Texas. And that was probably the worst place I've ever lived that I can think about. It was really bad. Even going into the Gulf to swim, the water was dirty. They had 2-inch long
roaches.
What?
Roaches?
Roaches, yeah. Calling on my kids all night long. God, it was the whole thing was just a miserable thing. The job itself was very good. It was operations manager for the Likes Caribbean line. They had 5 ships on that line, and it served the Caribbean. And I did very well with it, and I enjoyed it. And I had all the experience needed to have the job.
But wasn't the trip over there even bad?
What?
Wasn't the trip to go from New Orleans to Louisiana, I mean New Orleans to Galveston bad, that trip? You drove there?
Yeah.
Woody?
Yeah. Right. That's right. And I finally had this, sold the Woody. It didn't last. Too old. 48 Chevy. Anyway, so I didn't even have a car in New Orleans. I mean, in Galveston. Everything was by public transportation, and my pay was, it wasn't because they were treating me poorly, but the pay for that company was very, very low. And so when I got 2 weeks vacation, I took 2 weeks training duty in the reserve and came home to San Francisco with you, I'm getting a job. And I did. I was going to get one for American President Lines, but I got it with Matson Navigation instead, and because they were just starting their container program then, and I'd had experience with that in this, and so they were glad to have somebody that had experience with it. And the job I got was at least 2 notches lower than what I had in Galveston. And I got paid almost twice as much. You know, I mean, I got $400 a month is what I was getting in Galveston, and I got $800 a month I mean, there wasn't much question about what I was going to do. I got home and I got paid twice as much money. Yeah, so, and they were not. The Likes people weren't very happy with me. Actually, the last pay raise I got was the largest in that area for the year.
Oh my gosh.
I mean, so it wasn't me that they were treating, but it just, God, how can you, you can't, I couldn't live on $400 a month with, even then with the, at the time, family of three. I went to work for Mattson, and it was a good experience. I was learning a lot, and I gave them a lot, and but I'd been there 3 years. And they wanted to do something that was, they did something that was illegal. And they were renting these containers to people and charging them $1,000 to take the container to Hawaii of their goods, the whole thing. Well, that's fine, except that was somebody else's, they opened it up, the lock, and if there was space in there, they would put other cargo in there as well, and then relock it, and it went to Hawaii, and the people with the stuff on top had to collect theirs before the people that paid for the whole thing went there. And the guy that was the vice president of cargo at the time, freight traffic, I call it, was Norman Scott, Jr. He was the son of the Admiral Scott with Callahan that was killed at Guadalcanal. And that doesn't mean anything, it just hit me in the mind that his father would never do anything like that. And since I told him, I can't do this. I can't be responsible for this. They fired me. Right on the spot. Well, they fired me a few hours later. I went out on a job to check on something, and I came back, and they'd emptied my desk out. And they gave me 2 weeks' pay, and this is kind of interesting saying how it happened. It's the only time I was ever fired. And it's hard to think you're getting fired for, and I was doing it to protect them as well from the Federal Maritime Commission. If they'd caught it, they would have been, they were already in big trouble because of their rates with FMC. Mattson was. Mattson seemed to get away with things because they're the only ones that went only to Hawaii. And the other companies went foreign and was in competition. So Mattson had no competition.
Oh.
Well, anyway, so I got home that night, it was a Friday, and told Wilma that I didn't have a job. I got 2 weeks' pay and that's it. So I got a phone call from a chief clerk, a union chief clerk at the container yard where the containers were stored, who I worked with on a day-to-day basis. And he said, I heard what happened. He said, how would you like to be port captain for American President Lines? Now, here's a union clerk asking me this. Well, how could I say no to that? He said, well, this is the deal. On Monday morning, you show up at this guy's office, he's the vice president of operations for American President Lines. That's all you do. And I went there and he hired me immediately and I became a port captain for American President Lines, yeah. And I that was in 61 or two, something like that. So I met Uncle Al. You're right about, but this is just about the time that I met him. It was being 61. It was about the time that Athena was born. That's how I remember things. When who's been born, you know? It was about the time Athena was born. I met him at a meeting of the Alumni Association of the Maritime Academy. And he was important to them. Al Gallant graduated from the Maritime Academy as an engineer in 1940. That was the year before the war started here, the year after the war started in England. And he did a little bit, not much. He sailed on a freighter or something, banana boat for a very short time, and then went on active duty in the Navy. He was an engineer, and man, was he. He was assigned to the, I'm trying to think how to phrase this. Well, he was stationed in the Military Sealift Command, MSTS. That's the government's steamship line for carrying of all seaborne cargo for all of the services. That they merged, all the services merged in 1949. We didn't have an Air Force before that, we just had the Army Air Corps and that sort of thing. But then each one had, we're separate now. And, but all the air was flying was by the Air Force, and all the land was done by the Army, and all the seaborne traffic, people, the cargo, was done by the Navy. And he had gone through the Navy from the time he went to sea. It was assigned, Uncle Al, in 1940, he was assigned as a junior officer in the engineering department of the flagship of the U.S. fleet, the battleship Pennsylvania. Okay? Now, his goal was, when he graduated, to become it by the time he was age 25, to have a chief engineer's license and to be a chief engineer by the time he's 25. Well, that's a dream. No, not during World War II, it wasn't a dream. Because where he went to school and all that sort of thing fell by the wayside. The second the war started, could you do the job? He did, and the same thing with the Coast Guard giving you licenses. They didn't care how long it was. Could you pass the license, the tests? He did, and he was chief engineer, and he was a lieutenant commander, and he was going up so quickly, and he was the chief engineer of the battleship Pennsylvania, of the flagship of the U.S. fleet. I mean, you know, that's pretty remarkable. And he stayed on till the end of the war on that ship. And it never had to go into dry dock. Everything they did with their own personnel, any repairs and that sort of thing. I mean, but the school I went to did an awfully good job. They really did at that time. They're not doing it now, not at all. But because now the school is run by the CSU, California State University system. And so all the hands-on stuff is way down the list, very unimportant now. And it's all the other stuff you learn, you know, history and English and great, you know, wonderful.
It's good to know that, but it's not going to help you in your
life. No, it doesn't help. Uncle Al had the same thing. He said the same term all the time. When somebody brought some up and to do something, he said, is that going to make the ship sail better? He used those words all the time and stopped you. Wait a minute. No, it won't. So he after that, every job he had with the Navy was a large ship, aircraft carrier something, as chief engineer. He never had a job other than being chief engineer on a ship, except when he went ashore, he got a job as the head of the repair department of a shipyard. Mm-hmm. So, but...
He was at Pearl Harbor.
Oh, yes. That's a very important story. He was Catholic, and he... On December 7th, 1941, the Pennsylvania was in the shipyard, hauled out with two destroyers, there's pictures of it. And that morning at 7 o'clock, he got up and went down, it was a Sunday, he went down to down below to go to a nearby church to attend Mass. A bomb was dropped. I mean, we all know what happened after that. A bomb was dropped right over the compartment that he lived in, and everyone in that compartment was killed except him. He wasn't there. Now, needless to say, he never missed a day of Mass for the rest of his life. Yeah. So he, but I met him again when he was with Military SEALs Command. They were stationed at Fort Mason at the time. And he became... I was going to say part of my family, that's a gross understatement. He became the godfather of my children. And when he would show up, neither the mother or I were important at all when he was there.
That's right.
He would teach, this is how you make Uncle Al ice cream and all these things. He was just, this brings tears to my eye to think about how important he was. And years later, my fourth daughter became addicted to heroin, and the thing she did that was the worst ever to the rest of the family was she took money out of her niece's and nephew's piggy bank to buy drugs. And the rest, I saved her life because I think your siblings were going to kill her. Because that was not forgivable. So I sent her, and I called up Uncle Al, and he was in Hawaii at the time. And she says, well, send her over here. I'll take care of her. Now, this sounds like an open statement with no backing at all. Well, I learned that anything he said, I took for face value, and it all worked out always right on the button. And he was with her for a year and a half. He broke it. And every once in a while, she would call and tell, Dad, tell Uncle Al to not be so hard on me. Are you still clean? Yes. You think I'm a fool?
So what a wonderful life she's had since then.
Yes. And she came back. She had had a baby. And the baby was being taken care of by my first wife while she was in Hawaii. And... She, I had separated from my first wife at that time, and I was living in San Francisco, and, but she went to, went over there, and I don't know what he did, and I don't care. But needless to say, she didn't. He She went to Mass every day. You know, that part I know, and the rest of it I don't think I want to know. I don't mean it was evil. I just, you know, it worked, whatever it was, and knocking you off of, taking you off of heroin, anything's going to be the best thing. There can't be anything that you would disagree with, right? So, and since then, when she came back, she met a guy who's one day different in age of her. You know that?
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and she married him. And this is a long time now. That son of theirs has the little boy that she left with has grown and graduated from USF and is doing really well.
Wow.
Very well, yes. His name was Brian. Brian Moore, because he was born out of wedlock, so he took my name, our name, I should say, the family name, and doing fine. And then they had the two of them, Athena and Mike Butler is the guy she married, had another child. Her name is Martina, and she's about 25 now.
Already, that little girl?
I think so. She lives up in the
Seattle
area now. I remember seeing her the day she was born. I went to the hospital. She was born in San Francisco. And I went in there and I saw that, I didn't even get to see Tina. They just showed me where the nursery was of the babies. And there was little Martina. And I looked at her. And I remember this very distinctly, and I've said it over and over again. I came back, I said, you know, Tina, I'm not sure who the mother is. But there is no question at all who the father is. She grew up looking exactly like her dad. In a very positive way, you know. that really hit me. Gosh, I mean, usually you might wonder who the father is. Oh, no. But you know who the father is here. So I currently have 6 children, but I have uh, 17 grandchildren. And we were counting last night, I think we have 11 and one in the oven great-grandchildren.
That's amazing.
Yeah, isn't that some?
Yeah.
Anyway, going back to Matson, I stayed with Matson Lines until I got fired for that incident. I then immediately went to with American President Lines and as a port captain in San Francisco. That's when they still had the passenger ships. They don't have them anymore. And it was a good job, but I was at nights all the time. There was no extra pay for after hours. I mean, I had a flat salary, and that was it. I mean, I worked really, really long hours. And the only days I had off at all were days if there were no active APL ships in port.
Wow. It didn't matter days of the week.
Huh?
It didn't matter the days of the week.
Oh, nothing. Or the night. Night either. I had to be there when the ships moved, arranging all this sort of thing. That, And it was, you know, kind of a good job in the way of learning things, but geez, you know, it was very tiring. And then I was still in the reserve at that time, and one day, and now this is in 1964, I'm sure of that day. That's, you know, that's the day, that's the year that Kevin was born, isn't it? All of my daughters were born on odd numbered years, and my son was born on an even numbered year. I remember that pretty easy, not to forget. So the eldest was born in 55, and the youngest girl was born in 65, 5 years apart, except for Kevin was born in 64. Yeah, I remember that. He was born at the beginning of 64, and Mina was born in on Christmas. Within a day or so of Ondine's birthday. It's hers.
Marina's is December 6th.
December 6th. Okay, no, then that's not. It's a week off. Yeah, okay. Because Ondine was born on Thanksgiving Day. It just happened to be on the 25th that day, that year. Let's see now, where was I? Oh, yes, and I was still with Military Signal Command in the reserve, and still very active with that. And one day I was not at a meeting, a reserve meeting, for some unusual reason. It may have been a ship was in that I had to attend. So a guy came in from the largest adjusting company, claims adjusting company in the United States at the time, called Western something or other. I can't even remember it right now. And the guy there wanted to start a marine surveying, which means inspecting ships and investigating marine casualties and that sort of thing. Started based in San Francisco for the West Coast. And my boss, the captain, Captain Jim Kenny, was there and said, "You came the wrong day. We have exactly the person you need, but he's not here tonight, but I'll give you the names, and you can contact him." And gave me the name, and this guy called me up and said, "This is what we'd like to do." And I said, "Well, it sounds very interesting," because what was in the back of my mind, this is a way to start your own business. If I could get into it, I couldn't start a steamship line.
No.
You know, but I could do this. This is something you can do if you had. And I said, "Well, I'm very interested. I don't know that much about the insurance aspect, even though I know all of the other stuff you're talking about, probably better than anybody that you would have to do. But for this, he said, "Well, don't worry. We'll tell you. I tell you, that's the easy part." So they hired. What?
Was this General Adjustment Bureau?
That's it, yeah. General Adjustment Bureau. It had originally been Western Adjustment Company. Now, General Adjustment Bureau, well, that was the name of it. And, GAB, that's right.
I remember going to work with you.
Oh, is that right? Okay, yeah. And I started out, and now they wanted to have they had somebody in mind to be work for me up in Seattle, and so I had been there 4 weeks. I had just been in that job 4 weeks.
Wow.
When a 100-and-some-foot yacht, 108-foot yacht called Sobre Las Olas, ran aground up in Discovery Passage in Canada. Wow. Ripped the bottom open.
Yeah.
And the guy was an American, and the vessel was based in Seattle. It was American flag. So he immediately called his broker, of course, and he was up there, and so was his wife, and they didn't have a real crew. They had all himself, and he was another guy, same age as he was, in his 70s, that spoke Russian, didn't speak English, and then had an 18-year-old boy who'd never been on a boat before. That's the crew.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, his wife could cook. I'm not exaggerating. This is what it was. And I happened to be in Seattle to interview this guy. They were going to bring aboard. And they said, well, we've got a job. What is it? I only had my suit on. It was really something. I knew I had to get up there right away because there was nothing I could do down there, and nobody that I would know to talk to would know anything about what I wanted to know. So I went down to Lake Union and chartered a plane. And this plane says, well, I don't think I can leave because they don't let you fly at night in Canada. I said, oh, you'll be back by dark. And I knew he couldn't be. But that was how I got up there. And I got up to Discovery Passage in this little, it's called Campbell. Campbell River was the name of the little town. And as we went over, I saw the boat on the side, and oh shit. Went up there and landed. And I didn't get a hold of the owner right away, did whatever I could to get out to the boat to see what the circumstances were. And I did. And apparently there was a guy that they had hired, had a little teeny, you could call it a tugboat, but it was a 25-foot little boat. So I hired him immediately so that he wouldn't claim for salvage later on.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know I had authority to do it, but I knew that by the time I had that sorted out, it would be too late. Everything else would have gone down and sort of thing. So then I got a hold of a couple, a big tow boat and a big real good tug, and got in charge of a company that had big crane, floating crane, and bring up. And then I got... What I did? Oh, I had a guy. I was not a diver, mm-hmm. but I could get under to see what was wrong, but what needed to be done. So we even have pictures today of it. You know, you've seen the pictures, haven't you?
I have.
With me hanging on it on a line out and. Amazing. Anyway, we got it righted, got it partially plugged up, and I had this one guy that we were going to hire, and I did hire, his name was Coleman, to stay aboard. He had to stay aboard, and we're going to take this thing down to Seattle. We're going to stop. We're not going to pass go. We're not going to go. We're going to go straight to Seattle, or we're going to have all kinds of trouble in Canada.
Yes.
I didn't feel guilty about it. That because it was an American flag vessel,
mm-hmm.
and but I had employed Canadian people, mm-hmm. and I didn't have any money.
Oh.
You know, I didn't know what was going to happen. See, today I would have knew all, I've known all that stuff in a couple phone calls, but I had no idea what kind of authority I had. But
this is your first salvage job ever.
Yes. But the thing is, I realized, and I was, what, 20, in my late 20s,
yeah. You
know?
It's pretty amazing, Dad.
But I knew that that vessel was not going to make it, and there was going to be all kinds of trouble if I just didn't do this anyway. Mm-hmm. And, so we got the vessel raised and got it underway in the middle of the night. We got cleared through customs, and it was on the way down. I'm cutting out a lot of stuff that happened, but anyway, they were on his way to Seattle, to Lake Union, and then I got a plane to fly down, and I was trying to get a hold of Uncle Al because he had just retired from the Navy immediately, and I thought he might be in Europe. But I called home, and he was at my house.
Oh my goodness.
And I said, get on the plane, get up here to Seattle right away. I've got a myriad of engineering problems that I have to deal with. I can take care of the rest of the stuff, but that I can't do. And I met him, he came up and he landed in Seattle, came up and met at the shipyard, and between the two of us, we put together the findings and recommendations and all that sort of thing, you know. That part wasn't that difficult, I mean, you know, because both of us knew our job quite well. But it was insured for, I remember, for, it was about $100,000 was all. I mean, that's a very small amount of money for the size of the vessel and everything, but that was then. And the vessel was wood. It was built some real old diesel engines, and it was built by, I'm trying to remember, some famous movie star owned it originally. And it was built in 28. It was quite old, even by then.
And is this the one that was owned by John Wayne?
No, that's much later. But it didn't sink. Thank God. But we still survey the one for John, that belonged to John Wayne. Kevin and Heather do it now. I don't have to do that anymore. But we did get down, and fortunately, it turned out that there was no question about coverage under the policy, and they certainly would pay for the salvage and, you know, all that sort of thing. So that all came out okay. I didn't know it was going to come out. I had no idea what would happen. For all I knew, I'd be in jail. I had no intention of going back to Canada until it was sorted out, because I'd sure get thrown in the brig for, you know, committing all this money without having any way to pay for it. But there's certain times, things in your life you do. You just do. You know, you know that it's right. Like when I got fired from Matson, things like, you know what you're doing is right, and, you know, you just do it. There was one little event that I passed up that would be interesting for this. It was in 19, It would be in 1950. I'm trying to remember, 1956. When I was a navigator of the Caliani, we were tied up to a dock in San Pedro. Mm-hmm. And it was a wooden dock. And the ship I was on carried all kinds of fuel and stuff that was quite burnable, tanker. But we weren't doing anything. It was on a Sunday. And just fortunately, I was the duty officer for the command duty officer that day, and very fortunately, the chief engineer happened to be aboard. God, were we lucky! And on the dock, down the dock a ways, there were some people that were welding on something, and I don't know what it was exactly to start with. Why they were doing it doesn't make any difference. So they said, this guy, one of the petty officer came up to me and said, Mr. Moore, the dock caught on fire down there, the wood part of the dock, and it looks like it's coming this way. Shit, boy, I jumped out of there. Oh, my God, yes. So I got a hold of we didn't even have a boiler going. Oh, we had connected to the dock by power. Mm-hmm. We weren't doing anything. Mm-hmm. So I got a hold of Paul, the chief engineer. I said, Paul, this is what we got as a real problem. I want you to get all your boilers started as soon as you can. Get two of them at least to get started. And get as soon as you have any kind of pressure at all, just give me a call and we'll put them in. The port side we're going to put forward and the after side we'll put in reverse. And we'll pull away from the dock that way as much as we can. And then I turned to this first class boatswain's mate. I said, now you get down at the bow with a bunch of guys and chop that line. Don't try to untie it. Chop those lines right off. And I think he said something about somebody not liking that. And I said, well, that's tough. We're going to just do what I tell you to do. And we got off and back down and went out into the bay. And then when we weren't going to hit anything, I had him just drop the anchor. And, well, that was a chore too, dropping the anchor without very many people experience, you know. Uh-huh. But the main thing is, it was me and it was the chief engineer. I don't think the ship would have been saved without us being there. I don't think that at all. Because nobody else, nobody else had experience of that sort of thing that had background, you know, to do those things that we did, that we were taught.
Yeah, and it wouldn't have just been the ship, would it? I mean, wouldn't it have exploded?
Yeah, oh, yes, a lot else could have happened, yeah, because it was aviation gasoline, there's just a lot of stuff in our tanks. God, it scared the hell out of me, but you know, I just did that, and I did the right thing. Mm-hmm. And I just really did. I knew I did the right thing, and so somebody asked me, "Well, didn't you try to call the captain?" And I said, "You know, that never occurred to me." And the reason it didn't is, so what? What could he do? Nothing. He was at home in Long Beach. He had a home in Long Beach, so he wasn't that far away, but he couldn't get down to the ship before anything would happen. And
didn't you tell me that because of your education, you learned to do things yourself, not expect somebody else to do it?
Well, yeah, because that's the way it was in the Merchant Marine. That's the difference between that. In the Navy, they have all these different rates and petty officers and things that learn to do that sort of thing. So that's how you... I remember just before I had my 2 years was up on that part of active duty, the captain came to me. Although he didn't like me that well, he sent a fitness report out on me that said, honest to God, this is what it said in the remarks column. Said only one thing. It said, this is the best navigator I've ever served with. That's all he said. Now, that's a damning thing. He's not saying anything about how good an officer he was or that sort of thing. He just said this, you know. But anyway, he told me, he said, you know, if you want to sign up for go regular rather than reserve, we can arrange for your next, well, we would arrange for your next job to be a chief engineer on a destroyer. And I said, you haven't learned anything about me, have you? That's the last thing I want to do, the last thing I'd be capable of doing. I did everything you saw for me because of what I was trained to do.
Because you're a deck officer.
Yeah, I'm a very competent deck officer. That's, you know, I remember the captain of the training ship when I was aboard. He would tell us, you know, he was in the very first class that graduated in 1933. And he became the chief engineer, the captain this year when I was there. And he said, you guys have to remember this. You're going to spend many, many hours up on the bridge with nothing to do because you're out there by yourselves. You're just going from place to place. But when you do that, you have to be thinking about a problem that would arise suddenly. Think about it, what that is, and what would you do if that happened? And I learned that, and we benefited from that. We did that a lot. So you didn't sit down there, what am I going to do now? It's you did it right then. And that's how these things...
down uh-huh. to me. That's uh-huh. what I do.
Well, that's good. Right.
From spending so much time with you.
Yeah. Well, that's good. I'm glad. Yeah, because, but that's the answer. And you can't, I remember, and it happened for Ondine also. One time down in Pacifica, your mother was in school as usual, and that's really not a smart-ass comment. It's the truth. She was almost all the time in school. And Ondine was cooking dinner. And a fire got caught on the stove. The first thing she did was to get all you kids out of the house. Then came back in and put out the fire. Now, there's a lot of grown-up adults wouldn't have thought that. They'd stay there with the fire, and God knows what happened with the kids, right?
Mm-hmm. She's so smart.
Yeah, well, that's, hopefully that's something that she learned because of me, you know, talking about that sort of thing. After getting the ship off from that, my very first job with the General Adjustment Bureau, uh, They had no idea at first what I had even done. They didn't. They knew it was a good thing in some way, but they didn't realize how difficult that was mm-hmm. with how little knowledge I had, you know. So if I hadn't had the background that I had, I would not have known what to do. That would have been a bad thing. Some, a lot of pollution and everything else. Mm-hmm. But then, so I stayed with them for 4 years, from 64 to 68. Mm-hmm. And in 68, they told me that I was taking too much time reviewing the reports of the other people that were learning this job, and that they should be able to, by now, be able to just do it by themselves. And I said, well, that you can't do that. I can teach them certain things, but they can't have my background experience in a short period of time. Well, we can't afford to have you doing this. You handle the jobs yourself and worry about that. Let their managers learn to supervise them. Well, our managers didn't know anything about it. I mean, that was nothing. So that was what pushed my button. I said, well, this is telling me the time that I need to get out on my own. Because this is not going to go any. There's no good side to what's going to happen now.
Yeah, no.
And so I talked to a couple people, especially one or two. I was very well thought of by the insurance companies that we were doing work for. But when I told them that I was really going to leave and wanted to start my own business, they said, fine, we'll give you our business. And that really did happen. And I think the home insurance company was the one that was the biggest help in getting started.
Yes, I remember that.
And I went to, and I got this, and you came, you were the first one to come to work for me in a clerical mm-hmm. status. And we had this little teeny office, which was, you know, about the size of your living room. And there was no top to it. There were just sides to the, and it was just open at the top. And mm-hmm. so you could hear all the other people in their offices, different businesses and all that sort of thing. And so we got started in San Francisco on the corner. I'm trying to remember what corner it was. It was on Market and something else. Mm-hmm. And then later on, we learned that they were going to tear that building down that we were in. Mm-hmm. And I had to find some other place. So that's when we moved up the street to where Second Street dead ends into at the Hobart Building. Mm-hmm. And we got one room there. That's how we started, and then we expanded.
Yeah.
And our largest clients were from Lloyd's at London, mm-hmm. And did very well. But they didn't do so well because they were underwriting things that they didn't quite fully understand. And I told them about it. I said, this liability stuff you're doing is really dangerous in California. Well, they got burned pretty badly by the liability cases. You know, California courts would award huge sums of money to people for relatively minor things, and so they quit. Well, then our business went. In 92, our revenue for our surveying services was $1.2 million. In 93, it was 800,000. In 94, it was 400,000.
Oh my goodness. What a drop.
Yeah. And that's when I moved the office up to the farm. Mm-hmm. And up to our farm, and I, the apartment I had was going to come up for a renewal, and I decided I just would get out of that. And then, what was it? I told everybody that, you know, we're going to have to cut way, way back, and a lot of you people won't have a job. That's all there is to it. You know, I can't keep this up.
How many surveyors did you have at that time?
Seven. Mm-hmm. And three, and five gals in the daytime, and three part-time at night.
Wow.
And it wasn't wasteful. I mean, they all did a good job.
Yeah.
And, but... it was, but it, there's nothing, I couldn't possibly make enough new clients and get, to make up for it. So I, my big scare was, how was I going to get out of the lease I had on the office? At that, by that time, I had an entire floor, the 16th floor entirely, of that building. And I was really scared about that, because that, if they had insisted I stay the full 5 years, I would have gone bankrupt. There's nothing I could do about that. So I begged this gal. I said, well, this that was managing it, the building, I said, this is what I'd like to do. I really need to get out of here. And I'll leave. I had some valuable stuff that they would like to have. That I had purchased, a really big conference table, and it was brand new, and a lot of things like that, and chandeliers and stuff like that that I'd purchased. And I said, I'll leave everything here. That's the stuff, and then we ended up, I was so lucky that they let me get out, on the condition that it was some kind of a trade, I don't know where it came, if I would rent one room, just one room on another floor for 1 year. And I had to say yes.
Yeah. Even though you didn't use it?
Didn't use it hardly at all. Didn't use it for business. Yeah. But the movement worked out, and it cost me to build the two office buildings up at the farm and to transfer the stuff up, and then the whole cost was equivalent to 3 months' rent. And I owned the whole thing.
Yeah.
So that worked out really good. And that was in 94. And I never looked back. Now, the thing that made that available, to the way it was, it happened because technology had changed. When I first went into business, communication was just a little bit of telephone, but a lot of fax and mail. But as time went on, it improved, and fax was the biggest thing. Almost all of our communication was by fax. Well, then, but then, as we got into the early 90s, we started dealing with email.
And internet, yeah.
And that made the difference. Because that's what all our clients wanted. And there was no reason for me to be in San Francisco. I could be in Timbuktu, you know.
As long as you had a way to actively communicate with them.
Yeah, so it went. So I moved up in 94 is when I moved up to the farm, the business of the farm, and with one surveyor and one gal, I just lost, remember Kathy Ritter?
Yes.
I lost her because she went to work for her husband, mm-hmm. who she met in the elevator. Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
He was a delivered, there you go. People, stuff for attorneys. Services, you know, and that sort of thing, you know. And so I had one gal that came with me, and then Dana Teixeira did for about a year or so, and then he went out on his own. The others had all gone on their own. Now, I had, in turn, it's worthwhile commenting here. During the time that I had started my business, I had trained 23 surveyors.
Oh, my goodness. That's more than existed when you became a marine surveyor.
Huh?
That's more than existed in the area when you became a surveyor.
Oh, yeah, because there was not that many at one time. It was spread over a period of time. And so the last, and to now, and so the last two that I trained are Kevin and
your son
and your daughter
Heather,
and both, and those two now are running the business entirely. I'm not doing anything there at all.
And they're doing really well.
They are doing very well. They are doing really well. Yeah. For a while they were having some trouble, but. They both got in the business of getting new clients, because I told them, you know, you have to get new clients all the time, because you lose clients not because you've not really done a good job, because people have moved and new people are in that job, and there are just several reasons that that's going to happen all the time. You have to keep up with getting new clients, and they've done that now. They're doing it. So, I am unimportant at all, really, in the function of the business right now. You know, once in a while they ask me for some questions and stuff like that, but not really the big stuff. And they're not coming to me for decisions at all, which is good. Heather's doing really well, and much more so. In 1979, I was continuing my surveying business from San Francisco and had rented an apartment in San Francisco. But I really, for the future, I kind of wanted to have something better than being a rental. And so I looked around to buy some property up in Sonoma County. And I liked that area. And so after looking around, there was a place that I saw that I really liked a lot. And for $150,000, I could buy 5 acres with one house on it and the garage, and that's about it.
the rest down there too.
Oh yes, that's right. There was a building we called the barn, which was just a large garage sort of thing at the time. And then so I bought that with I think I helped a friend of mine for I think about $50,000 loan. And the main down payment I had was $26,000 of gold, literal gold. I actually carried it in my hand, but those gold, the bullions, and that's what got started. And I was really happy to get it, but there was nothing else on the farm, on that property, except weeds and a rusty barbed wire fence. That was it.
That's right.
And we started planting a lot. And we, the main thing we planted, we're happy with, was all the way around the outside, was we planted redwood trees 5 foot apart, all the way around, on three sides. One side was a narrow part that faced the roadway. And then we the house that was there, Andrea here, I had her move in with her family, and she had at that time 1, 2, 3. Was David born yet?
No, I actually only had 2 children at that time when we moved in there.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's right. You only had Forrest and Heather.
Heather. Heather okay. Was only 6 months old when we moved.
It wasn't that old. 3 months old. It was in October. She was born in July, and it was in October.
Oh, that's right. October 31st.
No, October 19th is when I bought the property.
Yeah, well, we moved in on the 31st. I remember.
Oh, well, that may have been, but that's when I got the property. And for several years after that, you stayed there. And then, yeah, that's right, year and a half later, Serena was born. And I remember you originally were going to use your sister's name, Sabrina.
Right.
And the midwife, I think it was a midwife, was there, thought you said Serena, which means a calm person. She said, well, this is a calm baby, that's a good name, and it stuck, even though that wasn't what you intended, right?
That's right.
I remember that, yeah.
She came out and smiled.
Yeah, and then a very short time after that, I remember that Heather came in the room while you were nursing Serena and pointed to your other boob and said, Heather's. Heather's. After we moved up to in 94, we're skipping around a bit, when I moved the business up, it was tough. Because we had lost so much business, whammo, from London, trying to keep it going, but gradually I was able to put it back together again, you know, and not easy. And so I'm trying to remember how long after that, I came up with the idea of getting Kevin to come down from Seattle. My son Kevin at that time was working as an event coordinator, manager for a large
for Bill Graham.
That was a long time before that.
That's right. Then
he was in Seattle, was working for this organization. I can't remember what was it. It was this, a county. Anyway, I'm trying to remember the name of it, but it was a theater, and it was all kinds of different shows were put on there and that sort of thing. And he was coordinating each of these, and he got a lot of interesting experience by doing that. But I finally talked him into coming down, and I gave him at that time the house that Andy had lived in before, in exchange for giving us, he had a very good job to starting from scratch with us. And then as time went by, it became obvious that the best thing to do is when I, at some time, turn the business over to him. And that hasn't changed at all. I mean, that's exactly the way things turned out. And as of last week, Heather now has 30% of the stock. Now, I did that because when my attorney told me that I should, I said, I'm going to give everything to Kevin. Nobody else has contributed to this at all. None of his sisters contributed to the farm, nor the business. And that's the only assets I have. And so, and I don't want him, because of my history with my grandparents and them giving stuff away and it, all the stuff being sold out from under, I didn't want that to happen. And it would have happened. So my attorney said, you have to tell each of those people or it's going to be hell for Kevin. Okay, I did that. And I told all the other four, you know. And the three of my daughters agreed that it made sense, because the whole idea, both Kevin and I had a common idea that we wanted to keep that farm for the whole family. And anybody could go there anytime they wanted and that sort of thing. I want to do everything possible, and I'm still doing it, to make it less trouble when I passed away for Kevin. Mm-hmm. Okay, now, if I put in my will a certain amount for Heather, mm-hmm, I can see that, well, what about us? Mm. But it says specifically, nobody else gets anything. And I named all of them. They don't get anything, only Kevin. Mm-hmm. Well, so the way I did it, I'm giving her shares now. So we don't have to worry about that, because I don't own those shares. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's the way it should be, really. Mm-hmm. And Kevin has now, the way it will end up when I pass, he gets mine, and he has 70% and she has 30%. And that's, all three of us think that's a fair balance, mm-hmm, given how much he's been in there longer and, you know, mm-hmm, and everything, and carrying the biggest weight. And so I just think it's right, and so does he. And it was 2 years ago that I retired formally, mm-hmm, and turned over the CEO authority to him. Mm-hmm. And so it's the last year especially has been very effective. Both of them have developed new accounts. In fact, she's developing a new type of business, inspecting wineries. Did you know about that?
Fantastic.
Yeah, as doing like condition surveys of wineries and that sort of thing. And you remember John Boletto?
Sure.
Okay, John is helping her because he's got it, yeah. It's, things are doing well. They're, both of them are doing really well. And the other thing that's good right now is, well, it's unimportant from this standpoint, but I really like Kevin's girlfriend. Mm-hmm.
That's great.
She's really neat. I like her a lot. And it's, so she does a little work for me now and then. You know, some But yeah, that's a big help. After I bought the farm in 79, it was intended right then, from the very beginning, that it was going to be the rest where I was going to live for the rest of my life, and it would be left to the family. And everything we did with it was with that in mind. One of the things we started right to begin with was to grow Christmas trees to sell. That was the worst financial disaster I ever got involved with. There was only one person in the family that made any money off of it, and that was granddaughter Heather. Because during the week, when people came up to buy them, I was working in San Francisco. Well, so I just told her, now we got the signs all over the place here, and when people come up to buy them, you just let them know that, you know, show them, let them what they could do, and we're selling them for $15 at that time, and you can keep $1 of every one to sell. She looked at me and smiled, you know, and she was way ahead of me. People would come, and I had these candy stripe saws for cutting them down. She said, "You want me to show you the very best one?" Oh, they really liked it. Her blonde hair and blinking blue eyes, you know. Oh, that's fine. Well, she would do that and get as much as $20 tips for this tree that she sold. Yeah, help cut them down, you know. So she was the only one that made anything off of it. We lost a lot. We planted 6,000 trees, and we sold very few. And that, so I... Then we had to get them, take them out, because they were taking up a whole lot of the whole... Yeah. It was a simple waste of time, but we did get rid of them all. And on that property now, we have... On the part of it, we have an acre and a half of fruit trees that have done quite well over the years. All mixture of fruit. Peaches, pears, apples, persimmons, plum cots,
figs,
and different varieties of each of those. So we have 72 trees that yield fruit, and most of which we can. We eat some of them fresh, off the tree, but more of them we can the product. We do not sell anything off of it. We give them away, or I give them away to friends and all, and it's because if you sold it, any product that you process, the health department has to come out and inspect. And the last thing I need to do is get involved with the health department, telling me how to make my trees or grow whatever. So I didn't want to do that. I figured just grow them, give it away to family and friends and business, and that's it, and can them. And I can quite a few jars a year, several hundred jars.
Delicious.
And the other thing is in addition to the fruit trees, we have we grow quite a few, about 24 berries, 24
canes.
What I'm trying to think of, 24 tomatoes. Tomato trees, or whatever you call them. And most of those we are aromas, and we make salsa and pasta sauce out of those. And I make quite a few of that. The salsa is specifically a big hit for a lot of people. Then the other thing is, oh, the berries. I had made loganberries and boysenberries, quite a few of those. And the loganberries we made in a jelly, and the boysenberries we make into a syrup. My very favorite is the loganberries because my grandparents used to do those. My granddad did. So we had that they did fine until the last couple of years the loganberries have gone down in quantity dramatically, and now they've been there for over 30 years, so they're really tired, and I've talked to people about what to do about the soil, that sort of thing, and I've had different things, but the best advice I got was from the county vintner, whatever you want to call him, saying that, well, the best thing you can do if you have a land nearby that's been fallow for years, that's similar to the land that you're growing on that did so well, plant in there, you don't have to do anything else. And that's exactly what I did. I ripped out the old ones and put brand new ones in this winter. Also did, my son suggested, and it was a very good idea, I was going to wait to do the boysenberries a couple years later, because they're still producing, although not as well as they were, but they're still producing satisfactorily. And he says, just keep those and go ahead and plant the new ones for those as well now. So in 2 years, when they're gone, you'll have it right away. So we're going to be approximately 2 years without any loganberries. But we'll have boysenberries the whole time. I'm going this year, since we're going to have it that way, I'm going to make some of the boysenberries in the jelly to see what happens. Mm-hmm. So that's how we stand there. The other thing is on the farm, we have chickens. And most of the other livestock is great-grandchildren who have a lot of fun. They've got a big place to play. It's really a big park. And we have a lawn that's about the size of a football field.
Yes.
And
surrounded by beautiful trees.
Yeah. It's really nice. And my granddaughter Heather has designed and built a cottage herself, a little two-story cottage herself, and she and her little Oliver live in it, and because she works full time with our business now.
She lives right there.
Right. And my son has improved the business from a financial standpoint in that he has altered things using modern technology, and we no longer need a secretary. He and Heather do their own reports, and it works fine.
That's great.
And the other thing is the problem with our having a secretary was that it cost about $38 an hour for the secretary, even though we were only paying her about $18 or $19 an hour in her pocket. But gosh, the workman's comp and everything else you have to pay in taxes is just eating us up. You know, we just couldn't afford it. So we're sorry to let her go, but and she was really good. But now we have two people. One is a friend of Heather's who went to kindergarten with her. I was her very first boss at 5 years old when they were working the Christmas trees together. And now she has some children, and she does some work, a little bit of work at home. And they can do it by the internet, you see. And there's a place for them to sit. Different people use that place, but we don't need to pay up anybody on a full-time basis. And then there was Kevin's girlfriend will come in and do a certain amount of work now and then, but it's on a call basis. It's not putting us in trouble. So that's pretty good. And I built a house that started out as 600 feet and ended up with 1,800 feet. And it's a really nice house now. It's got on the main floor as a living room and kitchen and a bathroom. And on one side has a separate dining room. On the other side, the house that has an extended, well, we call it a den, and it's now I use it primarily as my office because I don't even go in the business office anymore since I've retired. I don't want to have anything to do with it. They don't want me there either. I mean, it's just that way. Then the second floor is a master bedroom. And a second bathroom there, and in the other end is a smaller guest bedroom. And so we've got plenty of space.
And then the deck.
Oh yes, and then I added about the deck is. What is it, 20 by 20 by 12, I think it is. Yeah, anyway, it's on the second floor, about second deck balcony. I just walk out on it from my master bedroom, and it's kind of nice. And when I sit out on that balcony, I can see only my own property. It's kind of nice, and
you can view the whole thing all the way to the end.
Yeah, I can see all the way to the end of the properties, which is a quarter of a mile.
You spent many beautiful sunsets there.
Yeah, and the sunset's really beautiful. Yeah. When my son modified his house, the front that was there already, he expanded it quite a bit, and I used the rafters and framework from the upper part of it to use in my back and build a. Built a garage that's exactly the same dimension, and it works out perfect. It's a 20 by 22, and it's just great. So my car and our truck, farm truck, shares that space, and I use it for my shop. I don't share a workshop with Kevin.
You can expand on that if you want.
No, I don't think I need to. I different standards.
Yeah.
And of course, your daughter has a little of that too. You know?
Oh yeah. Whew. I
think one of the nicest days I can remember is when, within 2 days, she and Oliver and Lily moved out of my house.
Was that hard for you?
Hard. It was the most glorious day. I can't believe it. This is wonderful. Oh my gosh. It was really wonderful. It's been absolutely fantastic. So the only time I have is when I invite somebody to come in. Not, you know, don't have anybody coming in the middle of the night. Don't have, you know.
Yes.
It's.
And they're only a driveway away.
Oh yeah, it's only about 200 feet between my place and, well, the same to Kevin, and about the same amount to the north for Heather's cottage is what we call it. Yeah. Sometimes when she's gone on jobs, then I'll take care of Oliver, and right now it's pretty much mostly up to him whether he wants to be. He's getting a little older now, and he's got this rice little second floor loft. That's right, for himself. So he. He as much enjoys staying there as he just said the night with me, so in the spare bedroom. So it works out fine. He's not a problem at all. No. I grew up learning that it was the father's job to put food on the table for the kids, take care of their clothing, everything like that, and it was up to the mothers to raise the children. And that was very obsolete. At that time, that was the way it was. Mm-hmm. And I thought I was doing my job. Now, later I'm being criticized for not spending more time with the kids and blah, blah, blah. But you deal with what you know you think is right at the time, not what somebody thinks later. And that's why I'm so upset at people that are criticizing Jefferson because of his mistress. And what he did for this country, and to criticize him for that is just preposterous, that somebody would even think that, you know. Mm-hmm. He gave this country so much. You just open that paper, how could he even think all that? You know, and just worry about. And there was nobody ever criticized that he did anything bad to her at all. That was just the way it was. Mm-hmm. And if you go in there today to Jefferson's, to Monticello, mm-hmm. the first thing you see in the store is these books saying what all he did, the bad things he was doing because he didn't marry this woman. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I went there the last time I went there, I just left. This idea of rewriting history based on some standards that didn't exist at the time is stupid. But that's what happened. Anyway, then you're getting out of this thing that I'm dictating what was a life of somebody that grew up entirely different than circumstances are today. And so that's why I'm venting. When I was growing up, there was no such thing as medical insurance at all. It just didn't exist. You had a doctor, and the doctor would come around to your house, you'd pay him some money or whatever. And I remember Lily saying that, that's a lady that lived with me for some time, she would say they had 15 kids, and the doctor, a little Jewish doctor, would come around, and he was a German Jew. That's significant in during World War II. And he would take care of the family, and sometimes she could give him money, sometimes she would feed him, but that's the way life was. And that now, it isn't that way at all. People, I know a lady that does some miraculous things with back. I had a sciatica problem, and she fixed it. It's been going on for years, and she fixed it in just 1 month of four treatments. She had both an MD degree and had practiced and learned Oriental medicine as well. And it was wonderful. And I, after 1 month, I never had to see her again for that problem. I never had a single problem with my back after that. But I've given her name to different people. And there's some people, the people that use it are really happy. But most of them would say, well, will my insurance company pay for that? And I'm saying, you know, if your life is so shallow to you that you're, and your kids, that you won't go somewhere because an insurance company won't pay for it, I don't want to talk to you anymore. Your values are not like mine.
Your health is more important.
I would think so. Yeah, so, but they, today, the health that this, yeah. It's really something, you know. When my son Kevin was 9 years old, I was working with a friend that was a diver on some jobs in Sausalito, California. And we ran across an elderly wooden hull boat that was 9 foot long and about 3 foot wide. And it was in very poor shape. It was really falling apart. It was not reparable for use. But with my friend, Jerry Thompson, who passed away several years ago, we thought it would be nice to use the shape of the boat and make a mold. And then in the mold, make the hull of another boat of the same size. And do this, would be really good to do this from scratch with my son Kevin at 9 years old. He would learn how a boat can be built by today's way of doing things.
Which was fiberglass.
Out of fiberglass, that's right. And so we did that. It took a while, and my mind went, because of the size of it, went, this was going to displace the same amount of water that an El Toro would displace. That's a little bit different boat, but the same basic shape. It has the bow cut off of it, so it's only 8 foot, and this boat had 9 foot, but the overall shape was still the same. And so we first of all built the, took the old boat, turned it upside down, and laid a fiberglass mold around the outside of it. And that's done with fiberglass and resin. And let it sit. Then we turned it back around. And that became the form that we sand it off, smooth it up, and the outside of the lube boat would be in the fiberglass boat. So we then after laying in the new mold that was the actual hull that's going to be, then we could throw away that the outer mold and start forming what we had inside into the what we needed as a boat. I was convinced that the mast and sail and boom for an El Toro would be just perfect for this. And that just came to me. And in fact, today it's still in use that way. So we, in the stern and the bow, we made little areas that we blocked off. And inside was full of foam. And the same in the aft end was the same way across the transom. And it was full of foam, so that even if the boat got cut in half, it'd still be afloat. You couldn't sink it. And then the center, there was a centerboard, and there was a centerboard that goes right down through the hull that lifts out and puts back in again. And then I used the, I started to use a, the centerboard was the same centerboard as you had in a, No. It was a different. The centerboard on the, there was a board, oh, they had a lee board on the El Toro, but this, I used the centerboard right in the very, right through the center of it, and that made it much more stable. And you could just pull it out, put it back in, didn't make any difference. And then.
And why would you want that, Dad?
To keep it.
No, not why you'd want it down, but why would you want it to be.
So if you were going to go run aground,
exactly. I just wanted to explain it.
That's right. Yeah. So it would run aground, and it'd be easier. Well, what we had also is we had to have a trailer to put it on, so we'd want to pull that out so you could slide it up on the trailer. Then then the rudder. I was going to use an El Toro rudder. But it wasn't enough, because this boat, when we got through with it, was a little bit twice the weight of the El Toro, and we needed something with a larger rudder. So a guy by the name of that worked for me part-time. He did work in my house and things like that. He made a new rudder, much larger, heavier, much sturdier and everything. And that just slips out from the stern, from brackets. So it works fine. And it's large enough and everything to compensate for the additional weight that we had compared to the original one. So I don't remember how long it took us to do this, but we did it on weekends pretty much, and my son Kevin was with us all the time we did this, so he would learn how things were being done. And then I don't remember the exact official launching as what it was, but anyway, we put it in and we got
Didn't you also have teak rails, Dad?
Yes, I put teak rails in it all the way around, and then functionally very important was the fact that if I use this mast with this boat, we'd have a broken mast real quick. Mm. Because the mast, the boat was over twice the weight of it. Mm-hmm. So with the wind on that and this thing, just so what I did is I put a forestay and two side stays in to support it up quite a ways, so there wasn't any concern about it. So, in very heavy weather, it couldn't conceivably turn on its side, but it wouldn't break. Mm-hmm. So that was, and I then, after we got it going, I would teach. We took it out numerous times from Sausalito to through Raccoon Straits over to Angel Island. And with, I don't know how we got all the kids and myself in that boat without it. I think now, how can that be? But we did, and it worked. And they all got turns, you know. I didn't say all, I don't know that. I don't remember Marina, whether she was involved or not.
Yeah, and some of us enjoyed it more than others. So
yeah.
Like, I always wanted to take the tiller.
Yeah.
And the sheets, but I know Sabrina didn't enjoy it too much.
No, she, well, you know why?
Why?
That one time, she let the line go and it hit me in the head with a boom.
Yeah, she was holding the boom out.
Yeah, and, well, it was on a reach, and then she brought around so fast the whole boom whacked me in the head, and I was kind of dozy there for a while. And I think she felt bad about that. I think that may have been one of the reasons that she didn't want to do it again. You know, I don't think she came out again after that. And I guess I was harsh with her when I said, "You can't do that." Well, yeah, how are you gonna be nice about that? You know, no, thank you for hitting me in the head. You know? But anyway, the kids each had some experience with it. Then, for some reason, now we still have the boat, and for some reason, I don't know why, but it wasn't used for maybe 20 years. Mm-hmm. And trying to think now, about 2 years ago, there was a thought that Mason, Andrea's son, might be interested in it. So we fixed it up. We regurgitated everything, you know, fixed it. So we had a nice new sails and things like that. Nothing structurally had to be done to it, but I had to make it look nice. So, and what?
Clean it.
Yeah, clean it up and do some painting and things like that. Well, then they...
You took it back here to Utah.
Yeah, they brought it up. Well, before we went to Utah, we sailed on that.
Yes.
What's the name? Spring Lake.
Spring Lake.
In Santa Rosa, mm-hmm. And it worked fine.
Mason learned. Yeah. It was sturdy enough that he felt safe enough to actually learn to sail. Uh-huh. Before, he'd been on really rickety things, and he was always afraid of capsizing.
Yeah.
And that was the wonderful thing about this dinghy, is that
it was very balanced, yeah.
So you could really get the feel of the wind.
Yeah. And because part of it was, you know, my background, I had a sense of what was going to happen mm-hmm. before I even had to do that. But and the only one that I didn't do ahead of time was the, everything else I had figured out ahead of time, but the rudder. I hadn't realized was going to need a heavier rudder. I'm trying to remember the name of the guy who did it for me. He passed away now. He was 10 years older than I. So, yeah, and after fixing it up, that sailing, Andrea, I had a friend of mine do some work on the trailer and things like that, so they towed it, and they towed it up to Eureka, and I mean to Utah, and then...
Our lake is so polluted, we couldn't go out without...
Was that what it was? Okay.
Kids' health at risk. And I thought, this is a waste to have this beautiful boat here.
Yeah. So anyway, it's back there, but for some reason, and I don't know why, Kevin's son was not interested. And I really shouldn't have said it that way. I don't know that we even offered it to him, to Cameron. I mean, I can't remember any connection with him in the boat at all, period. But now, Oliver has great-grandson Oliver is interested in it, and we've been out with it on Spring Lake with Heather, you know, and unfortunately then the winter came along and we haven't been able to use it, but it's in really good shape, and no reason we can't do it again. It's parked right outside my garage there. Can be, and all the equipment's there and taken care of, so we at any time.
I'm so grateful that you taught me to sail it, uh-huh. You know, introduced me to it. I never would have known otherwise, and yeah. It's I love sailing.
Uh-huh.
I love sailing.
Yeah, well, the next time you come down, you can go sailing, and how's that? When you reaching your state of life that I am now, think very seriously about what your offspring have contributed to what you have, and take care of it while you're still around. The most unfair thing of all is to just say, oh, there's four of them, we'll just divide them into fours and then let them take care of that. There's going to be a lot of unhappy people by that, and it is almost certainly not equal to what they put into it. That would be such a freak thing, you know. In my case, I didn't mind. My mother had only two children, and her only asset was the house in Long Beach. And so I didn't make much of that at all. But when it came to pass that it was divided in half, she said she would, that's what I expected. My sister wanted to expand it and put another house on it for rent and things like that. And I said, I tell you what, sis, why don't we, let's get it appraised. I know you got it appraised for, it was $125,000. It's what they got it appraised for. I said, okay, sis, if you can come up with $50,000, I'll give you a quit claim deed, and you can do anything you want with the whole thing.
And that's what you went with.
What?
That's what you went with.
Yeah.
Isn't it? Yeah. That's what actually happened, yeah.
Yeah. But that was easy because, A, there was only two of us. B, I didn't want to be down there, you know, and it wasn't that I wanted money. If it's just greed you want the money, then it's really hard to look at things that's fair. Mm-hmm. Nothing comes out fair that way, I don't think. And that's why I feel that, think about who's contributed what. In my case, the only person that has contributed to my only assets are my farm and my business. I have no other assets at all, except books and stuff like that. But I have simply given it all to Kevin and none of his sisters, because none have contributed to the value of the business and the house and the properties. And he's done it for years, you know. And he and I have the same feeling. We want to keep it for the farm, for the family. Mm-hmm. And so does, by the way, does Cameron. And so I've changed my will to the point that if for some strange reason Kevin passes before me and it's not been sorted out, it would pass to Cameron, and he has already named Cameron in his will, so it's going to go out that way. The Moore family continues to have it, and Cameron's all in favor of that. So we all feel kind of confident it's going to stay with the family, and somebody's not going to run out for greed. Mm-hmm. And the only reason that either Sabrina or Marina would want it is more money. I can't see. Neither of them want to ever live there. Mm-hmm. There's no real reason. So I don't have any qualms whatsoever about what I'm doing. And I don't think anybody should, really, you know.
You do have another asset.
What's that?
It's what you're sharing right now. And that's what I wanted.
Okay, you got it. That's fine. You got it. Well, the other thing
your
is...
stories and your life experience.
Well, the other thing is... The other thing... There's something else, too, that you may not think of right now, and probably can't just now. The next time you come down, you see any of the things, books or stuff like that, that you would like to have, see, I'll just give it to you now. Because I don't want to deal with this in the will. The second I mention somebody else, then it's going to be, why not me? You know, I'm trying to protect Kevin, really. And in the long run, protect the property for the family. And it has to be that way. So I would like that. And, you know, I've already given some stuff to Forrest. Mm-hmm. And I've got lots and lots of books. I've got tons of books. You know, there's some that you might want to have.
There might be.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'd be glad to do that. And
I just want to let you know that the experience of living on the farm was such a gift.
Yeah.
For me and my children.
Yeah.
So thank you for that.
Oh, you're welcome. Yeah. I'm glad you appreciate that. Yeah, that's great. I mean, everybody, yeah, and, you know, it's important to Heather. It's all she has ever known. Mm-hmm. She was 3 months old when she was born. I mean, when we had it, so that means nothing, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Oliver, we're thinking about Oliver's going to high school now.
Oh yeah.
When he goes through the eighth grade at Collie, the school he goes to now. Mm-hmm. And the high school there is just really very special. Frankly, because there's an awful lot of money in Windsor. Mm-hmm. And the families all deliberately give all kinds of money to the to this high school. It's just really remarkable. People loved going there and everything. And he would have a lot of his classmates would be going there anyway. Because, you know, not many people live that far away as he does from the school. But so that's good. I mean, we're just thinking about, you know, how soon, what age he will be when he can drive, and how it would be if he bicycled over there. He could bicycle over there. He wouldn't have to use the highways at all. He could use that, you know, that back road. And he could do that, you know, unless it was a rainy day, there's no reason he couldn't bike over. I know we're talking 2 years from now, it'd be 13. I wouldn't worry about him doing it now, as far as being, you know, yeah, being squared away. Have you still got that going?
Yep, it's still going.
My great-great-grandmother was a princess of Denmark. Mm-hmm. And she married a footman. And it wasn't a big deal then. I mean, that would be
scandalous.
In the English family, it wouldn't go over very big in Great Britain, but he wouldn't have that. But they didn't move out or anything. He just stayed in and lived with the family. She was no longer a princess, but
she was still a daughter.
Still the same name, member of the family and everything. So, yeah. And her second brother, this is kind of significant, her second brother was appointed by Victoria to become a king of Greece. Why that would be? There was a disease that killed everybody in the royal family of Greece away. And the Greek parliament or whatever it was went to Victoria and asked her to appoint them a blue-blood king. And she did. And what's his name? Name will come to me. Constantine, yes, Constantine, that's it. And his son, how'd it work? And his son had two children, one of which was Albert.
Oh.
And Albert married an English lady, and they had, they were the parents of Philip, the current.
Current?
Yeah, you got them together, yeah. That's how all that fits together. Isn't that something?
That's amazing. But let's say it for people who don't know. He's the wife of the current Queen Elizabeth.
That's right. Philip is the current queen. Wife, yes.
Wife.
I mean, a husband.
Husband, yeah.
I don't think he speaks Greek. He wasn't born on the mainland. He was born on a small island. I'm trying to think of the name that starts with an M in Greece. And by the time he was 12 years old, he was in the Royal Navy. Mm-hmm. Said, what's that got to do? Well, that was very common, because at that time, every royal house in UK, in Europe, had either the king or the queen was a granddaughter or great-granddaughter of grandson of Victoria. So, you know, yeah, I mean, just think that the Kaiser in World War I, the Kaiser and King George V were first cousins,
yeah,
fighting on the opposite side, and so was the Tsar of Russia, yeah. So and others as well. But I'm just saying, you know, it's unusual. That was her goal, was to have relatives of everybody. And,
to unite everybody.
Yeah. Yeah. She didn't even want to get married to begin with, but then she met this guy, and she was really very much in love with him. What's his name? Victorian Albert.
Albert.
Yeah, Albert. That's right. And so he died at a very young age. And she spent the rest of her life kind of in mourning, really, in mourning. Not together, but not completely together, but she lived very little time in London, and she spent a lot of time in on the Isle of Wight on, where is it now? Osborne was the name of the city the building she was living in, right across from Southampton. Anyway.
So you are, you're related in a way
to Philip.
To the royal family. Yeah.
To Philip, yeah. I may be to somebody else that I don't know about, but I mean, for that way, by blood to Philip, mm-hmm. back, not to Greece, but back to Denmark.
Yeah.
Isn't that something? Yeah. We have the family Bible. You've seen it, haven't you?
I have not.
You haven't?
No, I would love to see that.
It's this thick. It's huge. And the last time that what's her name? Julie was up. She went through it, you know. And one of the things in the book is a. Is the name of Nana's younger brothers in there named. Younger son's name there, Fred. And his wife at that time. And my Nana cut her name out of the thing and scratched off her picture. It doesn't happen, right?